Y254. Imagine.
Hello there, 25th of February 2019. Many thanks for joining us on Top of the Hour. Tonight discussion Monday, we'll be looking at the corruption and we want to see whether we will move from handshake to handcuffs. With me in studio is Daniel Orogo and Ngunjiri Kariuki. They will be telling us whether we are fighting this demon called corruption. Keep it Y254 at Murani Hillary. Y254 channel is the Twitter handle to use. Welcome to the program. We look at the stories making news highlights tonight. My name is Dereva Hillary. Now, following the recent proposed reforms by the president, DCI boss George Kinoti has announced reshuffle at the directorate that have seen a number of senior officials move to different departments. He said that more movement would be seen in the course of the week across the board. In other news, the National Irrigation Board is on the spot over $200 billion tender for a multi-purpose dam in Kitui County. Already, the NIB has been fined $250,000 by the Procurement Tribunal for disobeying orders regarding the dispute that has dragged on since May 2017. President Uhuru Kenyatta Monday directed Madaraka Day to be celebrated from Narok County and not Kajiado County due to unpreparedness by the county government of Kajiado. The committee expressed concerns that Kajiado Stadium construction works may not be completed within the remaining 3 months as earlier envisioned. Elsewhere, eight constituencies cannot account for about 1 billion shillings allocated to them from the National Government Constituency Development Fund. Auditor General Edward Ouko says this is in a report covering up to June 30, 2017, that was tabled in the National Assembly last week by Majority Leader Aden Duale. Elsewhere, an Italian firm, CMC di Ravenna, that was contracted by the Nakuru County government for the construction of Itari Dam, has denied claims of its bankruptcy. The multi-billion controversial project has had several challenges that have led to its stalled progress. On university students have threatened to take the streets over plan increase to increase tuition fees. Speaking to journalists outside the university towers in Nairobi on Monday, student leaders from various universities declared that on Monday next week they would hold on countrywide demonstration to protest the raising of fees from 16,000 to 48,000. Now the Kenya Medical Supplies Agency, KEMSA, is facing a financial crisis of a delayed payment of $2.4 billion owed to aid by county governments, a development that is threatening to cripple medical services in the country. The crisis has since altered the Senate Committee on Health, which has summoned Council of Governors Chairman Weekly for prayer to explain why the counties are not meeting their obligations. And crossing the borders, Nigeria's civil society group says over 30 people have been killed in a post-election violence. Voters went to the polls in a tight presidential race between President Muhammadu Buhari and businessman Atiku Abubakar. The group say the death toll during Africa's biggest election were higher than that of the 2015 poll, which was widely considered to have been orderly, aside from Boko Haram attack that killed more than a dozen people. And now finally, Theresa May has again delayed a parliamentary vote on her beleaguered big Brexit deal in a desperate effort to buy more time to revise its terms with Brussels, with just 33 days until Britain is set to leave the European Union. Speaking to reporters while traveling to an AU Arab League summit in Egypt on Sunday, May said it would now happen by March 12, a mere 17 days before Brexit Day. You are now up to date with Y254 News highlights, and tonight a reminder, we'll be talking about corruption, and we want to see whether we are winning this fight against this menace in our country. And with me in studio is Daniel Orogo, a political analyst, as well as Ngonjeri Kariuki. Welcome, gentlemen, to our studios tonight.
Asante.
Now, we saw what happened last week at the Tanzania government jailed a woman from China, nicknamed the Queen of Ivory. And we have seen people being, through allegations in our country, corruption cases, that is. But then the question is, can Kenya be where Tanzania is like today? Ngonjeri.
Okay, Hilary, thank you for having me tonight, and I appreciate for the opportunity. First, let me infer the fight against corruption to the condemnation that it has even from the good books of faith. Mm-hmm. It is in the scripture, in the Bible, mm-hmm. Proverbs, that any ill-gotten wealth will not last for long. In the Quran, and in the book that they call the Kitabu Ayub, mm-hmm. a letter that was written by somebody called Ghuraib something, mm-hmm. says, do not acquire what you have not duly paid for.
Right.
From the Indian, mm-hmm. Hindu Bhagavad Gita, mm-hmm. when the war of peace, mm-hmm. between two conflicting sides, mm-hmm. on who should inherit the kingdom as it was in the families of Padu and Arjuna. Mm-hmm. The disciple of Lord Krishna by the name Arjuna is in the battleground and looks at both armies and sees relatives and friends,
right.
and wonders why should we fight
corruption
because of party or of properties. Mm-hmm. That was also tells you that the Hindu Gita, mm-hmm. does not compromise,
right.
on well that is ill-gotten, or a person who wants to get something that is not due.
Can Kenya be at that point?
Of course, we have seen a renewed fight against corruption, mm-hmm. and this has come in the wake of the handshake.
Mm-hmm.
This is a post benefit,
right.
Of the handshake.
All right.
Therefore, tonight I want to believe that Kenya, to answer your question, mm-hmm. can get to that point, right. where we say Kenya is a corruption free society, mm-hmm. and we can have an affirmation,
right.
of institutional justice, mm-hmm. whereby it will begin with each and every citizen, mm-hmm. taking their responsibility in the fight against corruption. Therefore, to look at it from what I normally like calling, mm-hmm. the prismatic angle, or from a wide angle, mm-hmm. I want to draw the responsibility of fighting corruption, mm-hmm. to the citizens, mm-hmm. to the government, and to anybody else, any stakeholder in our political and democratic ecosystem.
All right.
Yes.
All right. Orogo, before you respond to that, Kenya is perceived to be one of the most corrupt countries. And research in 2017, out of 180, Kenya was 143. We have had series of corruption cases like the NYS, the Eurobond. And now, given these observations, what measures can Kenya take to stem the snapping theft of public resources?
I think, first of all, let me join my colleague just thanking you for inviting us to this debate.
pleasure.
It's been a long time, and I'm happy to be back now that we are on DSTV.
We have been missing you.
We are happy to be. But let's begin here by saying that there is no, and I say it in a different platform. Mm-hmm. The problem that we are having as a country is that we've never found any word in our mother tongue that we can define corruption. Because there is nowhere, there is in your language, there is nowhere you can, what do you call corruption? In my language, what do you call it? But all our languages have got something called theft and how to deal with it.
Right.
So would we begin by, first of all, asking that our national, you know, our national intelligence and our national values must recognize corruption as public theft and public plunder. Mm-hmm. So that makes it easy to deal with thieves.
Right.
We can't know how to deal with corrupt people, but we know how to deal with thieves. From the thief of a village chicken to that plunders a lot of money, we know how to deal with them.
But
at least
they are treated differently by our judiciary.
But now, as we, this was just my opening remarks. Kenya has found its way in one of the, you know, like you said, whatever there is a survey that is done and a report is given and how we are faring in our corruption index. There is a sense in which we've never, you know, we've never gone high or down. We are always stagnant to some level. And you see, we are only compared to countries like Syria and other areas and Nigeria where corruption is the norm of the day. Mm-hmm. In this country, we have a robust constitution that really articulates on the values that we're having as a country. Mm-hmm. Our president and Her Excellency Uhuru Kenyatta has made it so right when he was in Kisii. Mm-hmm. And he said that when you're found corrupt, corruption does not align yourself to tribe. True. It doesn't align yourself to religion. Mm-hmm. It doesn't align. It is an individual responsibility. But what we really need to see is a lot of concerted efforts insofar as fighting corruption is concerned. And my colleagues who've read elaborately about Building Bridges Initiative, one of the, amongst the pillars they've mentioned is corruption. And dealing with it, how I wish that our friends would, you know, channel their views to Building Bridges Initiative as to how do we specifically deal with corruption, and as opposed to how we should be, you know, finding our way to do referendum in Building Bridges Initiative.
True.
So I think this is the trajectory that we should be, you know, taking as far as this discussion is concerned.
We have seen people being accused, especially in the NYS. They go to court, but we never see the result. Now, would you say the judiciary is undermining the fight against corruption, Mujeri?
Well, let me first begin by underscoring a very weird statement that has always been smeared on corruption. I hear that there is a new description and a new adjective in town that corruption, in some good words, is the cost of doing business. Okay, I tend
at the expense of the mwananchi.
Yes, at the expense of the mwananchi, notwithstanding the kind of adverse effects that it has on the economy, on the social contract, and on our politics. Coming to your question on the issue of NYS and whether
the judiciary
is actually interdicting the war against corruption, we have a reason as Kenyans to doubt the judiciary.
Right.
Of course, coming from what they have done in the past, I don't want to get into specifically into the judiciary per se, but I want to quote what has been in the public domain.
Right.
Allegedly, and as you have seen, the judiciary has made some weird rulings, which even a layman can be able to look at them and wonder whether this is justice as served, as it's supposed to be served. Therefore, I believe that we have a reason to doubt the judiciary, and to some extent, yes, the judiciary has taken, has played a role in frustrating the war against corruption. Of course, even quoting mm-hmm. the Director of Public Prosecutions, mm-hmm. Nudil Haji, right. and his adverse opinions on how the judiciary mm-hmm. has been taking matters corruption. We have so many problems, of course, coming from lack of enough anti-corruption courts. Also, we have seen some of the lawyers who even admit in public that they know which judge takes bribes. Therefore, I believe coming from what the judiciary has given us,
right.
we have a reason to doubt them.
Mm-hmm.
And also, lay some blame on them.
Right.
It is time that they put their act together
mm-hmm.
and also precipitated this war, because we have also seen the judiciary also being accused of delaying cases.
True.
Yes. So, and it is good that we are having this discussion here
mm-hmm.
and also advising on policy.
True.
Because the judiciary also needs to pull up their socks to some extent
mm-hmm.
and make sure that they, even if it means banning midnight oil,
mm-hmm.
let them prosecute these cases as fast as possible so that Kenyans can get...
But you understand, I agree with so much of what my colleague... Listen, fight against corruption is multi-agency
mm-hmm.
and we have very... three or four offices that, you know, are really trusted with fighting corruption and are given what I call quasi-judicial authority to expedite what corruption is. One office is the office of, ODP, the office of DCI, mm-hmm. and Ethics and Anti-Corruption Commission.
Mm-hmm.
So before I presume that before a case mm-hmm. is presented to the judiciary or any court of law,
right.
due diligence might have been done, should be done, so that we have a watertight case.
True.
And that even goes on with even how we, you know, investigate even before we forward this files for prosecution.
Mm-hmm.
So I agree to some extent that, you see, judicial officers are human beings. And you see, there's a sense in which their nature as human beings might compromise the cases that are before them.
Mm-hmm.
But you see, we also need to look at what is the role of other you know, agencies insofar as probably, you know, presenting to the judiciary a very tight case
mm-hmm.
so that it's not thrown away because of lack of sufficient evidence or proper investigation.
Mm-hmm.
And now coming back to what you just mentioned, at the anti-corruption conference in Bomas of Kenya, something caught my eye. And when we begin to politicize the war on corruption, it becomes a problem. A few days later, one of, you know, the Jubilee henchmen says, you see, we were discussing corruption, but whoever we were discussing was also present. So you see, whenever you make such statements and, you know, everybody draws your attention, now people begin to hear, do we call for these conferences to discuss people or do we call for these conferences to diligently
right.
deal with matters of national importance.
Mm-hmm.
So I think one of the areas that we are also doing badly as a country mm-hmm. and which President Kenyatta has in the spirit of handshake
mm-hmm.
and he should, you know, it should look at these as a way of, you know, in his first term, when there were corruption allegations and expose,
mm-hmm.
for example, Eurobond, people would sit on the fence and point fingers and mention names and come up with, you know, tribal mobilization.
Mm-hmm.
Our people are being, you know, haunted and our people are being treated unfairly.
Right.
NASA, by that time, was it called NASA or which affiliate? Cord, by that time, would sit on the fence and say, you see, you need to do this.
Mm-hmm.
Jubilee would defend it the following day. You know, so that become, it was becoming a problem to tackle corruption, but in the spirit of, you know, working together. I think that right now you've seen both the principals and both opposition leader and the president
right.
are saying that even if the governor that affiliated with my party is phoned
mm-hmm.
to be eligible, I think the prosecution body should take in charge
right.
and follow up through the process. It makes it more easier.
Yeah. All right. We will be taking a very short break, and when we come back now, we will be seeing at what should the judiciary do, among other things, to ensure that people caught or if people are prosecuted, due diligence should be done in terms of finding hard evidence to ensure that these people are jailed. We take a very short break. Do not go too far.